I'm Dan Drake. This is Front Up on Geno TV and Channel 99. Good morning, Rick Atherton. It is wonderful to have you with us.
Morning, Dan.
We've got a few things to talk about.
So we got two cameras here, Dan,
we got two
right?
cameras in the new studio. Or three, actually. One, two, three.
All right.
Yeah. And I think the first thing we should talk about is the sort of the aftermath of the vote on the Madigan sewers, which were turned down, probably in part because of your impassioned plea in your letter to the Inquirer and Mirror.
Well, maybe in part, but I think there are all kinds of reasons. You know, that's only one part of it. I think the amount was an issue, how it was being paid for was an issue, concern about the landfill, you know, all of those things.
And, so, and also, I think, when the vote was held. I submit that was one of the things.
One that you mean in because that might have impacted turnout, for
right.
example?
Yes.
That could well be. So one of the initial questions going way back when was whether or not this should have been an annual town meeting and a vote after the annual town meeting as opposed to a special. And when there are significant zoning or capital items, we ought to think about that as a town because you get usually get a better turnout, Dan. So
right.
that's an issue.
Right. Anyway, where do we go from here?
Well, I think at the moment we're going to have to revisit a number of things, it would seem to me. One, for example, the question of the administrative consent orders in Madigan that have sort of delayed some of the conversion to alternative systems. I think the Board of Health has to look at that again because there's a judgment call. Those were all entered into thinking the sewer was on its way. And while the sewer could still be on its way at some other time, you might have another vote. But in the meantime, it doesn't look like that.
Right.
And I don't know that we can wait. And the Board of Health, a couple months ago, voted to adopt a policy that if you put in an alternative system, you wouldn't have to hook up for 10 years anyway. Mm-hmm. So even if people put one in now and the sewer came in 5 years, they have a hiatus in terms of trying to recoup their investment, so to speak, Dan. So I think there's some protections for people in Madigan. But in the meantime, you do get a reduction in the nitrogen going into the creek or into the pond,
right.
you know.
Which is what the whole idea.
Which is the whole, the TMDL is
I mean,
in the
if
creek.
If we'd actually made people put in the, enforce the inspection system to begin with and made them put in the alternative systems 5 years ago, the problem might have been dealt with by now.
Dan, exactly. So, you know, we've been in sort of this, you know, you might call it a delay mode with good intentions. I don't think people were trying to miss the ball here, but nevertheless, that time frame, as you say, and I think a number of people in Madigan, the vote in Madigan wasn't clear one way or the other, is my estimate. And I think some people there were concerned that we weren't enforcing putting in alternative systems and that, as you say, might have helped. And I think the question of the landfill is still out there.
That was my next topic.
You know, well, it's an important issue because we're taking all of our sludge and so forth. And I've never been in favor of another line landfill because to me what we're doing is, you know, we're importing all this stuff from off island. Everything goes through the landfill and the residuals that we can't compost or they're not C and D that goes off sit in a lined landfill. So we're building another area to
another potential time bomb.
Yeah, for forever is
right.
the theory. I mean,
right.
now some people hope that that could become fuel for some kind of a power production system at some point, gasification. But you know, that's been, you know, 10 years into the future for 10 years.
Right.
And it just doesn't seem to be on the horizon. So I'm not in favor of starting another mountain, so to speak. And even though it could be expensive, I think we need to find alternative ways to take care of that, doing off our. One thought is to go back to treating the landfill like a transfer station. So what you can't take care of properly here or recycle, we transfer and we ship it off island, just like the vineyard. So we should, and the contract with Waste Options is what, coming up in another 7 years or something anyway. So we really have to address this now. And you know, former selectman Tobias Glidden was good when he was on the board. Said, "Folks, you got to pay attention to this," and he was right.
Do you think there's the will to do that?
Well, I think there might be. I think there's a, frankly, a certain amount of inertia in the town because you've got a system that's ongoing now, and to interrupt that and have to design a whole new system.
I mean,
system,
to plan for.
I think this is going to help get that off the dime, Dan. I really do.
Because there's been one theory for many years that while there has been water testing in Long Pond, that it really hasn't been very effective or very accurate. Or if it is, it hasn't been publicized.
Right, right. And I know that the consultants at some point said, yes, the landfill could be an issue and we need to test it more. Well, thanks a lot. Mm-hmm. That's the kind of thing we should have been doing coming up to this decision-making right. process, you know. And the data going into the models is 2010. You know, that's a long time ago now.
That's right.
A lot of building has occurred, changes have happened here that just didn't get updated. And I think all of these kinds of issues impacted some of the voters mm-hmm. and cumulatively right. they said no thank you at this time. So,
what are the other hot button items in the Board of Selectmen now?
Well, hot button items. Obviously, we continue to have to deal with our island home and the location of that. The board has voted that it feels the island home construction should move to the Sherburne Commons mm-hmm. site, but clearly there are some members of the community that are concerned about that and prefer it where it is. And, you know, that it's really, I think, very unfortunate because there, I don't think the logic is on the side of keeping it there. I'm not in favor of that. Mm-hmm. The board
had voted. Isn't it a flood zone too?
Well, there, you know, it's a zone of some kind. Right. I mean, I'm not sure I can tell you exactly whether it's a flood or this or right. that, but clearly it's on the harbor. Mm-hmm. And with sea level rise and storms coming in, nor'easters, mm-hmm. there's always risk. But that isn't the only reason. I think in my own mind, you get a better package to have the Sherburne Commons activities, mm-hmm. to have our island home.
Services,
yeah. You may even want to move the Salt Marsh and Senior Center to that location as well. And you have a real center of activity for all kinds of senior citizens and more resources
on
the
site.
Well, we are, Dan. We're not, yeah. But that's an important. The problem, though, is that in the meantime, the building that we have is taking capital improvements, mm-hmm. which are, in effect, required. And so if you
put in good money after bad, really.
Dan, you put in new air conditioning or whatever and it costs you $150,000, and if we move or reconstruct, either way, that $150,000 is useless after a year and a half or 2 years. Mm-hmm. So it's really, and the committee is going to be difficult. I'm a little concerned that it's not going to come out with anything other than what the folks mm-hmm. on the committee want. Mm-hmm. So we're going to have to tussle with that at next town meeting.
What else? Affordable housing?
Affordable housing, you know, I've been one who has often felt with affordable housing, a primary responsibility goes to the employer. Mm-hmm. And, you know, employers, a lot of our businesses have taken care of that. If they're a restaurant, often they own a house or two and they can house some of their employees. NIR has housing for a lot of their summer staff. So a lot of people have taken care of housing for their employees. I think it's the sort of strength of construction and activity on the island that is probably driving the current crisis, if you will. I think if we all go back and look at the newspaper in 2005, we'd see similar headlines. There was a strong economy then, and it's not really a brand new problem.
You say a business should take care of itself, which
if it can,
ideally I agree with you. Yeah. But the problem is that market of quote affordable, forget right. affordable in the legal sense, but realistically affordable housing stock is rapidly disappearing.
No, I understand. There's not an easy solution here. Right. So really, I've been happy to support the housing project. Mm. At Fairgrounds, okay, we have part of the reason to buy the property right. in the first place, and if we can, we were talking a couple of weeks ago of putting up 64 units and getting a request for a proposal right. out, and we hope to have that come back to the board and mm-hmm. resolve some of our discussions, mm-hmm. and I would hope a part of that could include a priority use of some number of those units for town employees.
I understand that's been, had the plug pulled on it.
Well, I think there are probably ways to design that so we can accommodate. Mm. I mean, there were kind of conflicting goals that went to be on the shy list, so you counted on the number of affordable units from a state point of view. So that was one goal of the project. But another was to, because this is sort of town-funded town land, to have a priority for our community need to have summer specials on the police force or the DPW and those activities. I think there may be a way to reconcile those and get some of each, Dan. You know, they start out by saying no, but you got to keep working at it. So all of these things keep bubbling up, and they're interesting. They're not easy issues to resolve, and we have some healthy discussions. I mean, just the discussion last night about how to finance the improvements that are going to be necessary along the Old South Road corridor. Mm-hmm. Boy, you look at that map last night, and, you know, from the Rotary to the intersection at Fairgrounds, to Amelia Drive, to where the Richmond Project is going on, out to Macy's Lane down near the airport for you, that whole road is going to have, it's going to be a lot of money. And how should we pay for that, and who contributes to
that? We just freed up $80 million, right?
Yeah, I look at the 80, you know, interesting, I look at that a little differently. It seems to me that
I was being partially facetious.
I know you are, but
not entirely.
Not entirely. So some of that 80, you know, if you spend some on the landfill and some on, you know, working through other parts of the project, you know, you might find that there the combination of those meets the need, and you've spent $20 million instead of $80 million. I mean, I'm not sure how that'll work out, so we'll see.
In that vein, let me interrupt for a minute. Mm-hmm. One of the issues in the harbor still, we've taken care, hopefully we'll by 2018 or 19 or whenever, taken care of the sewer issue in Main Harbor. Mm-hmm. We still have runoff to deal with. But the other issue we have to deal with is gray water for the boats in the summertime. Right. How would you feel, this is just an idea that I've had, and I just wondered how you what you think about it. If the town were basically to pay for the sewering of the boat basin.
That's interesting. So that boats there could easily hook up, just like they do to power.
Right.
Well, you got to think about that a little bit. I mean, who pays for it?
That's what I say. If the town, and my, you know, obviously, again, ideally, the owner of the boat basin would pay for it.
Right, right.
But I'm suggesting that maybe in order to get it done and get it done effectively and so forth, that it should be.
Well,
project.
I think that maybe it could be a shared project
shared
in some way.
Or paid for by user fees and so forth.
Yeah, I mean, you know, one of our favorite citizens came before the Board of Health a couple of months ago, our friend Mr. Bender. Mm-hmm. And
his shtick. Yeah.
Well,
and he's right.
And he's a smart guy. Yeah. You know, we need to pay attention and not dismiss his concerns. Right. So as the Board of Health, we said, look, can we find some off-island person, you know, MIT or Woods Hole or somebody, to come and talk to us, seriously. Right. So we need to resolve these kind of different points of view on gray water. Some people say,
it's illegal, first of all.
Right.
So you start with that.
And that's so interesting. And then why the harbor master's not finding a way to enforce it.
Right.
You know, their choices are being made. Mm-hmm. But it's on the Board of Health radar now, really, thanks to Steve Bender. And we're going to get back at that. Mm-hmm. This Board of Health has been, I think, really quite good, and even adopting the regulation to require alternative septic systems in the Nantucket Harbor watershed, Dan, as properties transfer or they fail their inspections, that's a major step on this island to do that. And we may have to do some of that in Matticat along the harbor itself and have the same kind of treatment on both harbors. So.
It's interesting, in Matticat, just an aside, there's a new home on Eel Point Road facing the harbor.
Yep.
In the back of the property, it's a 3-plus acre property.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
In the back of the property, there's a solar array. In the very front of the property, closest to the harbor, is a septic system.
Right. Well, that's just a good example.
Yeah.
Why did we do that? You know, who knows why, but and if it's a regular Title V or is it an alternative system?
I don't know.
I'm not sure either. And maybe tight tanks are appropriate that close to the water in Matticat, you know, and we hear from the consultants, well, the state...
I don't know whether the Board of Health or the plumbing inspector has the power even to tell them where to put it.
Well, they may not if they come in with a plan. But I think, you have certain setback requirements and so forth. As long as they meet them, that's maybe what we have to do. But we maybe should revisit those. Mm-hmm. And so if a site has...
Well,
it's too late now. But, you know, for the next one that comes along, maybe we should say leach fields have to be at least 300 feet back from the harbor if it's possible, whatever.
Yeah, right.
So there are additional regulations we might look at. I know in terms of, as you say, the runoff issue, I mean, how much... And this is something Mr. Fee's been concerned about, and the number of square foot houses and how much runs off and where that goes, it all contributes, and we need to look at all of these issues. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I think taxes, I mean, 80, but, you know, back to the sewer thing, $80 million is a lot of money, even on Nantucket, Dan, and I think that, you know, got people's attention, so.
What are your plans?
My plans?
Your plans.
For what?
For your future as a selectman.
Well, I don't know yet. I've said to people that I haven't made a decision on whether I'm going to pull papers and file them and run again. And I may want to do that. I mean, I'm in good health, Dan. I'm.
Would that be your fourth term?
It would be a fourth term. Right. On the other hand, sometimes, you know, who knows whether the voters accept a fourth term or not. So it's not only my decision, it's up to them. But I enjoy what I'm doing. It's a challenge, and you're always trying to get the information and work out the best solution. And I think I do add to the mix. I've got a lot of experience with Bobby choosing to go off the board. You know, Matt has his experience, but I think I add to the mix. So it would be up to the voters if I decide to run.
Do you have things that really compel you to try to seek a fourth term in terms of unaccomplished goals?
Well, you know, I hear that a lot. Gee, I want to run because I have these three things
exactly.
I want to do. But, you know, I've been involved long enough. There are always new things. Mm-hmm. And no one specific thing is driving me. I think of it more as trying to make sure the town is making good decisions, has good management, and information-based judgment on issues. So, and I think that's across the board. And you've got to work on that because there's a tendency sometimes to be in a position where you got to make a decision and the easiest way is this way and you don't take enough time, which I think has happened in the sewer issue. So
I've asked you this before and I'm going to ask it again.
You can ask it again.
Do you still think that the form of government we have is the best one?
You know, I happened to talk to a guy the other day who was from, I think, Greenwich, where they have a three-person board and an elected
town council.
A town council of I don't know how many members. And like Falmouth has an elected town meeting group, but it's a much bigger group. So there are alternatives. You know, I don't know that changing the form would make all that much difference. We tend to have town meetings twice a year now. There aren't that many decisions which have to get delayed in a critical fashion, Dan. So I'm a bit of a traditionalist, I admit to you, in the form of government. We've been at this in Nantucket for, 300 years or whatever. And times change, but I don't know that this is as... I think it does work. Meeting every week and sometime every other week during the summer, most things the town needs to get done through the administrative staff of the departments. And it's as effective with a five-man board as with some other way, I think. So
the planning department is sort of one of the reasons for my question, because they have mixed loyalties, you know, in terms of reporting to the Nantucket Planning and Economic Development Commission, which is a state agency, basically, and yet working for the town.
Dan, look, I've been long public in my position on that organizational structure. I was not in favor of the contractual relationship that exists today. I don't think it's the right way to go. I think the town planning director should report to the town manager. That's the way it is in virtually every town in the Commonwealth. That makes sense. And the NP and EDC, you're right, is a, you know, it's a different relationship. They were established, I feel, for a different purpose way back when. So I have not supported that relationship. And I think the town would function a little bit more effectively with with having that contract be set aside. And someone can fill both jobs if they want to. I mean, obviously Andrew Vorse is skilled and good at what he does, but he could be the town planning director reporting to the town, and the director of the NPNEDC if they wanted to do that. It's nothing incompatible with that in my mind. Two different responsibilities.
Good. Well, Greg, we'll look forward to hearing what your decision is. And,
well, we'll see. January's coming around the corner, Dan, so we can't, it'll happen soon enough.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very good.
Good to see you.
Thank you.